comes from John 20, 1 through 18. It's a very familiar story, a very appropriate story for today. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went out to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked at the strips of linen lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. And he saw that the strips of linen were lying there as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and he believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she went over to look at the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot, and asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this time she had turned around and she saw Jesus standing there, but did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking that he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried, "Teacher." Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he has said these things to her. These are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. But I ask for your help this morning. A little congregation participation, if you will. My title today's sermon, "He Has Risen Indeed." And at certain points in this sermon, I'm going to say he has risen. And I would ask if you respond, "He has risen indeed." So I'm going to drop it on you a few times, all right? He has risen.
He has risen indeed.
Before I move forward with this story, I have to take a step back. I have to take a step back to last Sunday, Palm Sunday. The day we celebrated Jesus' triumphant entrance into Jerusalem. There was excitement in the air. People were waving palm branches. They had a lot more life in them last Sunday than this Sunday. There was excitement in the air, and those palm branches were waving, and there was a shout of chorus, one chorus of "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." What a difference a few days can make. Dried up like last Sunday's palm branches are the attitudes of a lot of the people in the crowd. Jesus is denied, he's betrayed, he's beaten, and he's bloodied. This beating itself should have killed him. I read that a lot of the men didn't survive this beating. The happiness of those hopeful hosannas has turned into a cold and calculated call to crucify him. Why? What had he done? Healed on the Sabbath? That was only part of it. The big thing was, they said they accused and found him guilty of blasphemy. They asked him who he was. Was he the Son of God? What was he to say? He was the Son of God. He said, "I am he. I am the I am." He was telling the truth. And he died for our sins. There is nothing normal about this death. He used some of his last moments in the flesh, offering the kingdom of heaven to the sinner. He used some of the last moments in the flesh, asking his Father to forgive them, for they know what they have done. By now the Son won't even shine. All of the mocking and the insults, but now he is separated from his Father. Never before has he been separated like this. And he calls out, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" For the first time in Scripture, he refers to his Father as God. This separation is caused by our sin. Matthew's account of his death says that the earth shook and stones split and tombs opened up and the bodies of many of the dead, holy people, were raised to life. And suddenly those soldiers that were slinging insults and slinging those whips just hours before were now convinced themselves that this is the Son of God before them. How do you think those soldiers slept that night? Probably not very well at all, thinking about what they had done. If that were the end of the story, we'd be in trouble. But it's not the end of the story. We sing a song usually this time of year. And I love the song. And nobody really gets credit for writing the song because it was an old spiritual song that was sung. And I'm going to take this out so I don't blow you out of the church. It goes like this. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, to tremble, to tremble. Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they nailed him to that tree? Were you there when they nailed him to that tree? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, to tremble, to tremble. Were you there when they nailed him to that tree? Were you there when they laid him in that tomb? Were you there when they laid him in that tomb? Oh, sometimes it causes me to tremble, to tremble, to tremble. Were you there when they laid him in that tomb? It's a song about death. But we're talking about a life today. A life that was resurrected that day. So because of that, I had to go in and write a new last verse for that song. Were you there when they rolled that stone away? Were you there when they were you there when they found nothing in that tomb where he lay? Were you there when they rolled that stone away? That's a story about life. That's what we're talking about today. That life that was sent here for us, because of us, to die for us. And our scripture this morning opens with Mary Magdalene discovering early in the morning that she got up early. She got up early. She didn't hit snooze on this one. She got up early on that day and saw that the stone had been rolled away. Now she needs two witnesses for this. So she runs and gets Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one that Jesus loved. Well, let's talk about that. The one that Jesus loved. There are some people that say for sure, without uncertainty, that was John. I'm pretty sure that it was John. I kind of would like to think that it could have been Lazarus, too. And some people think that it could have been James. Regardless of who it was, this disciple that Jesus loves is in a foot race with Peter, and he gets there first. This disciple that Jesus loves was mentioned four times in the book of John. He was at the Last Supper. He was at the cross with Jesus' mother. The rest were in hiding. And Jesus said to him, "Take care of my mom." He was in our scripture today at the tomb. And he was there when Jesus appeared at the Sea of Galilee. And we talked about it before. Jesus has these nicknames for some of his disciples. He calls James and John the sons of thunder. But think about this name. You're going to be given a nickname by the other disciples or by Christ himself. How great would it be to be known as the one that Jesus loved? So imagine there had to be some jealousy amongst the disciples. All right, here he comes again. Oh, still just talking loud. There had to be some jealousy among the rest of the disciples. Here comes again, the one that Jesus loved. Teacher's pet. I'm sure that existed even then. But the one that Jesus loved, that was a good nickname to have. And he's the one that got there first, and he looked in to that tomb. Perhaps he saw something that maybe the other disciple didn't see. Saw those clothes were all neatly folded up. And he put together that this was probably not a grave robber. So they had gone back. And Mary stays behind. Notice it's Mary that stays behind. She's still uncertain. She's still unsure. And she's probably got more questions than answers still. Crying uncontrollably through her tear-blurred vision, she looks into the tomb and sees two angels. And they ask why she's crying. And then she turns, seeing the one that she believes is the gardener. We can't blame her for not noticing who he really is. She thinks Jesus is dead. She is struggling emotionally to figure out what's going on. She didn't realize at first that the gardener was Jesus. Sometimes those things that are right in front of us that we're seeking, we don't see. We still have a big old Siamese cat named Sam. I tell you, Sam has the perfect life. He sleeps like 22 hours a day. He gets up and he eats. And then he plays for about 2 minutes and then he eats again and he goes back to sleep. Well, a few years ago, Sam decided to get adventurous and he got outside. And we were just really, really distraught and saddened. We were praying because we couldn't call him, couldn't find him. This went on for a couple of days, and we've gotten these flyers and put them up on telephone poles and all over the neighborhood. I think we had it on Facebook, and we were getting the word out, Sam is missing. And every day, for on and off during the day, we'd go to the back porch and we'd call for Sam. Didn't see anything of him. One night I had been off work, and the next morning I just had this gut feeling that I heard something on the back porch, or maybe that Sam was there. I don't know. I don't know what it was, but I went and I turned the light on. And there was Sam. And I turned the light off and I walked away. I saw Sam. I knew it was him. But I wasn't expecting. I was hoping, I was hopeful, but there was something there that I wasn't expecting to see. So I turned the light back on. Thank goodness Sam was still there. I think we all have difficulty realizing when God's working. The obvious is right in front of us, yet we rely on our own ideas, ignoring the very fact that with all things, God is possible in all things. Maybe your situation seems hopeless. Maybe there are issues or burdens in your life that you have not completely given to God. Proverbs 3:5 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not in your own understanding." And I believe that we should trust God's will. Trust God's plan. Notice when Mary recognizes Jesus, it's not at the sight of him, but in his voice. In John 10:3-4, it says, "The watchman opens the gate for him, and his sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out." Jesus goes on to say that he goes on ahead of them, and they follow him because they know his voice. Isn't it comforting to know that the one that called the stars by name, the one that knows the number of hairs on our head, who puts our tears in a bottle. The psalmist says, from everlasting to everlasting, God's love is with us. He has compassion for his children. He knows how we are formed, and his righteousness is with us. God is fully aware of who each and every one of us are. And now that Mary is fully aware that this isn't just the gardener she's speaking to. And I find it something too that Mary was the one that stayed behind, maybe in faith, maybe even still unsure, but she stayed behind and she was rewarded for her faith. By staying behind, she was the first person that Jesus revealed himself to. I want each of us this morning to remember, with this resurrection, there is renewal and there is hope for each of us. God has the power to change us and our circumstances. God is in control. And we look to him and turn to him. We can faithfully be assured that the outcome will be according to his plan. Jesus himself knew what it was like to pray to God and not get the answer that he was asking. In Luke 22:42, it says, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done." Paul writes in Romans 8:28, "And we know that all things God works for the good, for those who love him, for those who have been called according to his purpose. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor demons, neither present nor future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ." God loves us. We also know that because of the resurrection, that sin can be overcome. One of the best descriptions of what Jesus has accomplished for each of us is found in 2 Corinthians 5:21. "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Not only can our sins be removed, we can be renewed in our thinking and in our behavior if we are in Christ. The resurrection proves that God can bring renewal. Something else that we learn from this resurrection: the grave is not our final destination. John 14:1-3 says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. In my Father's house there are many rooms. And I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go there to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you there, so that you may be where I am. And I should trust in God that this life is not all there is. The struggles, the hardships, the obstacles that we face will be forgotten in the glory that is to come. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, and he asks, well, how important is this resurrection? Well, Paul's writing to some churches that have seemed to have fallen out and don't believe in the resurrection. And just paraphrasing, what Paul is saying is that this is important. That if it weren't for the resurrection, our faith would be useless. If it weren't for the resurrection, then Christ died for nothing. We would have no hope, Paul is saying, if it weren't for the resurrection. What does this day mean to you? How long will the joy and the excitement and the hope and the assurance of Jesus' love for us last? Will it disappear like the last chocolate Rice Krispie Crunch Easter bunny? Will it fade like those shouts of Hosanna on Palm Sunday? I think about the kindness and love Kelly and I talk about it that seems to be everywhere at Christmas. Well, almost everywhere. If you're at Walmart and they got one of those TVs left that's $100, there ain't going to be a whole lot of love there. There's probably going to be in there.
That's right. Yeah.
We got a witness right here.
Yeah. Give me from my sins.
But on December 26th, it seems business as usual. When we allow the renewal that is the resurrection that it brings, when we allow it to remain in our hearts after that last piece of Easter ham is gone, will it last after that last Easter egg is found a few weeks later by the lawnmower? My hope and my prayer for each of us is that the remembrance of this day remains for the days and the weeks and the months to come. And we find ourselves next year entering Lent season again with the same joy and excitement that this day has brought. I serve a risen Savior. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
All right. I serve a risen Savior, and an empty tomb is there to prove that my Savior lives. Death could not hold him. The grave could not keep him. And that stone could not seal him away from us forever. Christ has risen.
He has risen indeed.
I ask these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.